Okay, welcome everybody to our, this is the name of the group I should start out with, is Society of Biblical Scholarship. We're on Facebook, so check us out. Every Sunday night, we discuss reading that we had done from some book relating to New Testament or Old Testament biblical scholarship. This is our last hangout and discussion of this book, The Bible Unearthed, Israel Finkelstein, Neil Asher Silberman, which very briefly deals with the interface between what archaeology has told us from the region of Palestine and what the biblical narratives from the Old Testament, going from Genesis up to the end of the Deuteronomistic history, and how they mesh or don't mesh in some cases. So, anyway,
in this part of the book, we've gone outside the Deuteronomic history and we're dealing with the prophets and other sources of biblical material.
Exactly. Yeah, it's kind of like a summing up chapter. We read chapter 12 and then the epilogue, which was just a couple pages, and the appendices, which, as we were discussing earlier offline, that they just kind of deal with a little bit more detail on some of the specific archaeological theories about, like, when exactly was the dating or setting of the patriarchs? Where exactly was Sinai that Moses was wandering? Whereabouts Sinai? Stuff with Davidic and Solomonic dating. Boundaries of King Josiah's kingdom. Boundaries of Yehud, which was after the return, after the Persian return. Anyway, stuff like that. So, chapter 12, what do you guys think? Any general thoughts on it, or anything specific that you liked in there?
Yeah, I got so into the book for the last hangout. I actually read this before the previous hangout, along with chapters 10 and 11.
Oh, cool.
So,
well, one little detail I found interesting was speculation, I guess, from Friedman, Richard Elliott Friedman, about, they were saying that he seems to credit Ezra as the final redactor, or one of the final redactors of the Torah, and, well, it would include the history too, right? He would have redacted that as well. Is that what the claim is?
Yes.
I think
okay.
So.
I think so, yeah. I love Friedman. I need to get more of his books.
Me too. I need to actually read from him. But I thought that was really interesting. And they mentioned one thing in the text about, you know, I'm sure there are other reasons that Friedman goes into why he thinks that, but there was a mention, I think it was in Chronicles or Kings, about, you know, him being the scribe of the law of the God of heaven. Oh, sorry, that is from Ezra 7:12. So whatever he was, if he wasn't the redactor or the final redactor or a key redactor, he seems to have been some really important scribe, at least. So, what's that you're holding up, Wayne?
Oh, just one of Friedman's books.
Oh, okay.
Giving him a bird.
Gotcha.
It's backwards.
I can't hear you at all, John, or hardly at all.
John mentioned that the text was backwards. I've noticed that everything that Wayne holds up is backwards to us.
Nobody's told me that before.
Oh, really?
Right.
Yeah.
Am I better now?
Not really.
Super a little bit low better. Volume. By the way, that on that idea of Ezra being the final redactor, which I did find interesting, but I was trying to think of it along with his idea of there being two different layers of Deuteronomistic history, like a, anyway, what, I'm not sure what you would call it, like a D1 and a D2 kind of.
Yeah, Deuteronomy 1, Deuteronomy 2.
Yeah, and would that make Ezra, if he was the one? By the way, Wayne, now I see it forward, whatever you did.
Yep, I fixed it in Medicamp.
But would that make Freeman's theory be that Ezra was Deuteronomy 2?
I'm not sure. I think they're just saying that he redacted all that stuff. I'm not Is Friedman arguing that he actually wrote?
I don't think.
This book would probably tell me. I have to look for it, though.
Is that better?
Yeah, that's
yeah,
a lot
better. You could be a little bit better job, but you're better.
Deuteronomy 2 would be not the redacted. They would be different. One would be a source, and then the redactor is a wholly different thing, or redactors.
Yeah. Some of the stuff they're talking about here, well, and just for the sake of the whoever views this after, chapter 12 is basically dealing with the return of some of the people who had been exiled from Judah in Babylon, and some of the later, I'm sorry, some of the prophets like Ezra, Nehemiah, Jeremiah, talking about that whole time period. So one of the things that I thought was interesting was this Deuteronomy 1, 2 strata that scholars are identifying. And what do you guys think about that? To me, it seems like it has a high, let's say a high ability to be contrived, I guess. Like, how do we know that certain things are Deuteronomy 1, Deuteronomy 2, if, I mean, it seems like they're going through the whole thing and seeing, like, okay, here's some stuff that's definitely post-exilic, but then here's some stuff, like, in the same chapter of a book, like 1 Kings or something, that seems to be really concerned with, like, the monarchy or something like that. So I can see that there's probably a good case to be made for these two strata, but I'm just wondering, like, do you guys know how strictly or how definite they like define these two layers, or just that there seems to be these dual characteristics going on throughout the history? Do you guys have opinions on that?
I agree with you that it seems at least initially quite contrived, and I mean, it seems to be very useful as a hypothesis, and you know, and we find in the text things that fit those two layers, but yeah, it does, in a sense, seem like we're making a theory to fit the evidence to work how we want it to work.
Well, what I was thinking, too, is, let's just say for the sake of argument, this stuff is all post-exilic. Why would it have to be, like, say, the stuff that seems to be concerned with the monarchy, why couldn't that also be post-exilic? And it's just, since they're writing, you know, from the present, being a post-exilic present, they still have this memory of the history of the monarchic period, you know, before the fall of Judah. Why is that necessarily, that stuff that's concerned with the monarchic period, not post-exilic? Or why couldn't it be, I'm wondering?
I don't know.
That's just questions I had about it.
I could read there seems to only be one paragraph in here regarding the difference between D1 and D2. I mean, he has them for Deuteronomy in his color coding. He has them colored differently, but his introductory material is mainly talking about the evidence for the divisions of J, P, and E from D.
Okay.
And that, you're not, he's not really dealing with D, it's Deuteronomic itself, but I'll read this one paragraph to you.
Yeah.
Final main source is known as D because it takes up most of the book of Deuteronomy. More specifically, Deuteronomy comprises a law code that takes up chapters 12 and 20 through 26, known as DTN, an introductory text that precedes this law code and casts the book as the farewell speech of Moses before his death, taking up chapters 1 through 11, and then a continuation of this text following the law code, taking up chapters 27 through 30. It also includes two old poems that are included as a parting message from Moses for the future, chapters 32 and 33, and also includes reports of the last acts of Moses, bringing together portions from all of the sources, J, E, P, and D. D is part of a longer work known as the Deuteronomistic History, DTR, which includes the books of Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, 1 and 2 Samuel, and 1 and 2 Kings. DTR contains sources that are as old as J and E, or possibly even older, but the formation of the work took place in the reign of King Josiah of Judah, circa 622 BCE. It was later extended into a slightly longer second edition, This took place during the exile that followed the destruction of the southern kingdom of Judah by Babylon in 587 BCE. The original Josianic edition of the Deuteronomic history is called DTR-1, and the second exilic edition called DTR-2. All these sources and editions are put together by an editor into the final five-book work. This final editor is known as the Redactor, or for short, R. He pretty much says the same thing that Finkelstein and Silberman were saying, though. Didn't really have much to add to them, but...
How, just out of curiosity, what books are in that book that you held up? Like, it's the got the
only the Pentateuch. I wish it had more. I mean, yeah. I'm looking for a Friedman book that has Joshua through 2 Samuel, but I haven't found one yet.
Yeah, I'd love to read
that. Or Joshua through 2 Kings, I mean, but yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to have a historical book that color codes the Deuteronomy 1, Deuteronomy 2 sources and just kind of see what they're looking at.
I also have this book, but this has a different purpose. This traces the J material, which he believes does not end in Deuteronomy, but actually continues through the discussion of Solomon.
Interesting.
But yeah, I'm still looking for a good book that shows the documentary hypothesis for the Deuteronomic history, all color-coded.
Yeah.
Well, technically speaking, there is the documentary hypothesis does not deal with the Deuteronomic history.
Oh, okay. Right. But how should I approach it then?
Joshua's part of the Hexateuch, yeah, that would be...
Okay. But still, it seems like even though, yeah, the documentary hypothesis doesn't deal with the history, but...
According to Freeman, it kind of does. I mean, he says J continues, you know, past the Pentateuch. He has D1 and D, and, you know, Deuteronomic History 1 and Deuteronomic History 2 divided, both in Deuteronomy and in the subsequent books. So
yeah, but I don't think DTR 1 and 2 are documentary sources. They're something else. They're not part of D, right?
But they're inseparable from the documentary hypothesis in a sense.
Well, that's his version of the documentary hypothesis, where... Others just say there's a D source. He divides it up, and he only deals with it within the Pentateuch in his book, Bible with Sources Revealed, and who wrote the Bible. But you know, I don't know how like DTR 1 and 2 and DTR itself extend beyond that in his work. I really don't know.
Yeah, that's my question. Is DTR 1 and 2 referring simply to divisions of the D source or to the whole history, including Deuteronomy, the book of Deuteronomy?
Well, specifically in the D source of Deuteronomy.
There's actually
three Deuteronomic sources, according to Friedman. There's a DTN, a DTR 1, and a DTR 2.
Okay. So the history that the historical books say, Joshua up to 2 Kings... that stuff isn't divided into pre-exilic, exilic, post-exilic, right?
I don't think there's. Well, I'm sure there's scholars that have dealt with that issue, but
I think that's exactly what Friedman and Silberman and Finkelstein are saying. Yes.
Yeah, that's what I thought, but I don't know. I'll have to go back and reread that part because I'm getting confused.
I think John's just complaining that I shouldn't be using documentary hypothesis as a term for that. I should reserve that term for just talking about the Pentateuch. But this entire question of identifying sources for the entire Old Testament is an interesting question. I'd like to see a color-coded, you know...
Is there an example
of what Friedman's theory is?
Is there an example that we have of a text that they would say is DTR 2... Because he's made a case so far that he feels that Deuteronomy, I think, fits a 7th century, everything in it, let's say everything that the Deuteronomist wrote seems to fit a 7th century composition, but is there something in DTR 2, a text that would force a scholar to say, no, this is written after the exile?
Well, listen to this thing on page 303, the last paragraph in chapter 12. Thus arose the distinctive edition known to scholars as, and this, the paragraph before is talking about the Deuteronomistic history, and that'll become clear as I read. Thus arose the distinctive edition known to scholars as DTR2. So this is the updating, the necessary updating by the returnees from Babylon of the history, and maybe even possibly the Pentateuch. I don't know. That's where I'm confused. Whose closing verses, 2 Kings chapter 25, verse 27 to 30, report the release of Jehoiachin, or Jehoiachin, however you say that, from prison in Babylon in 560. So obviously at least that verse is either late exile or post-exile. That means, of course, that 560 is the earliest possible date for the composition of DTR2. Its treatment of the death of Josiah, the reigns of the four last Davidic kings, the destruction of Jerusalem, and the exile displays almost telegraphic brevity. That's 2 Kings chapter 23, verses 26 to chapter 25, verses 21. The most conspicuous changes are those that explain why Jerusalem's destruction was inevitable, despite the great hopes invested in King Josiah. In insertions into DTR1, a second Deuteronomistic historian added a condition to the previously unconditional promise to David. That unconditional promise is in 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 4, chapter 8, verse 25, chapter 9, verse 4 through 9, and inserted ominous references to the inevitability of destruction and the exile throughout the earlier text. For example, 2 Kings chapter 20, verses 17 through 18. More important, he placed the blame on Manasseh, the archenemy of the Deuteronomistic movement, who ruled between righteous kings Hezekiah and Josiah, and who came to be portrayed as the wickedest of all Judahite kings. I can't tell from reading that section if it seems like there's just another addition and updating of the historical books.
So in other words, we have two different perspectives that we see it clearly two different people presenting different viewpoints. One has a rosy picture of this divinic dynasty that has an unconditional covenant with God and expects great things, and the other one has to kind of explain how it is that now it suddenly seems like a conditional covenant, that even they have to explain why it is that Jerusalem was doomed to finally be destroyed by the Babylonians and blame it on Manasseh. It's a clear distinction of perspectives that has to represent two different authors.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense to me too, because like you said, they had to account for this unexpected, you know, tragedy befalling their nation. And the other thing they talk about is how they dealt with the promise, well, the promising period of Josiah's reign and what eventually ended up happening after his reign, or shortly after his reign, saying that, well, his righteousness really only served to delay the inevitable. So yeah, it looks like clearly, well, I mean, obviously, just from some of the historical events they're recounting, like they said, the release from captivity of King Jehoiakim, obviously, that's, like they said, that means earliest 560. So there's definitely later stuff in there, and so it would make sense that, yeah, they're having to reinterpret some of this earlier stuff from Josiah's reign.
Yeah, as John said, Friedman does divide it up into three sources. Just browsing through the Bible with sources revealed, Chapter 31 of Deuteronomy seems to be the only chapter where I see all three sources on one page here. But you can see in its color coding, that's from chapter 31.
Can't really see the color. It looks like green and blue.
Yeah, it is green. There's just a bold blue and a light blue.
So there's
different blues and one different green, but yeah.
Gotcha.
I didn't quite... DTN is the green. And I didn't really catch the explanation of what the DTN source is supposed to be.
I think he said that was the law code stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
I know the DTR1 and DTR2 I caught, but I didn't catch what DTN was. Okay.
Yeah, because he said in Deuteronomy you have the first few chapters, Moses' farewell speech, and then you have that interjection of the vast law code, and then you end Deuteronomy with a continuation of Moses' farewell and death.
Oh, well, yeah, I read it wrong. I read it. I didn't realize the end was the R. I read it as an R, but it's actually an N. Okay. So a law code that takes up 1226, known as DTN. Okay.
Well, let me throw into the mix the question of the P source, the priestly source, because he's talking about that as a post-exilic source. Does he feel then that, would Friedman think that Ezra is the P source?
No, I think Friedman says that Ezra is the R source, the R, which is basically the final redactor that brings all the sources together.
So the P was written after the exile, but before Ezra?
Probably, yeah.
Or possibly even during the exile, right?
Yeah. I'm waiting for John to answer.
Well, to me, that's kind of problematic. I mean, the P source would have a very narrow window to do any kind of final writing before Ezra showed up.
That's true.
Is the P and E sources supposed to continue outside the Pentateuch, or are they just in the Pentateuch? Under, like, Friedman's view or whatever, do you know?
No, I've never really heard it discussed. I think it's
limited to... He says that J is outside the Pentateuch, and Deuteronomic was outside the Pentateuch, but I'm not sure about P and E.
It's also, like, saying that J continues is kind of, like, problematic, too, because... I think even Friedman would say the J source is confined to the Pentateuch, but there's another body of writing that extended it at a later time into the Deuteronomic history. So it's not really like the J source is continuing. It's like those themes from the J source are being expanded literarily in a later period.
I'll keep that in mind when I read his book, The Hidden Book in the Bible. But from my initially scanning this book, I don't think that's what he's saying. I think he's actually saying it is that J was an isolated ancient book that got included in our Bible. Everything from, you know, Genesis to Solomon.
That was my impression, but I could be wrong.
Yeah, either of us could be wrong. So I haven't actually read it yet. I've only skimmed parts of it. Anyway, we're supposed to be talking about the Bible on Earth. So.
That's okay. This is related to this chapter, so I mean, because this obviously this stuff deals with the importance of figuring out where the sources come from, especially this Deuteronomy, so and the history. Another interesting thing was Reuven might know more about some of the details of this, they didn't really go into it, but just kind of caught my eye was the rejection of the returnees. As they're rebuilding the temple, they refuse to let the Sumerians assist in the building of the temple. I'm wondering, like, they didn't really say why, other than, like, you know, there's a quote in Ezra saying, "You have nothing to do with us in building a house to our God." Like, were the northern people still not in the fold of Yahweh only cult at this late time, or was there just like an ethnic or historical animosity? Or like I remember we were discussing last time the possibility that some of these people had been imported by the Assyrians in the exile of the northern, the defeat of the northern kingdom. So I don't know, what, Reuven, do you know more about that? Like why the Sumerians were not disallowed from helping in the building, or anyone? Does anyone have any more to say about that?
That's what I had said last time, was that my understanding was that they were the importees from the Assyrians, these foreigners that were rejected as a result of them being foreigners, but Reuven made a comment that, like I said, these are the Samaritans. Maybe that's the only part that Reuven rejected. He said the Samaritans are... They are Israelites. Basically, they've been with their DNA, and they match that they are the same people.
Yeah. Even that.
Go ahead. Sorry, Wayne.
Even as late as Herod's temple, there's actually a plaque that we found written in Greek which basically gives a warning of death to any foreigners entering the temple area.
Yeah, because, I mean, anyone was allowed in the outer court, right? But then as you go successively in, it becomes more and more restrictive as who can enter, right?
Right.
I'm not sure what time period that relates to, but I think so still in that time.
Yeah. Oh, Herod's time, for sure.
Yeah, it's Herod's temple we're talking about.
Yeah.
Is it definitely, does it say in the Bible that these people were northern people? Because to me, it's like, why would they even care?
Well, it says they're, I'm not sure. Let me look it up, because here in the book, it actually only quotes from the Bible part, or it says, "You have nothing to do with us in building a house to our God," Ezra 4:3. But it says the people of it. The book itself seems to be summarizing the other parts, saying that the people of Samaria came and tried to help.
What page is this on? In
299. It's right after the block quote. The paragraph right after that. Yeah, now the enemies of Judah and Benjamin, this, I'm reading from Ezra chapter 4, heard that the returned exiles were building a temple for Yahweh, the God of Israel. And they approached Zerubbabel and the heads of the families, and they said to them, "Let us build with you, like we seek your God, and have been sacrificing to him from the days of Esarhaddon, the king of Assyria, who brought us up here." Now that's really interesting. That's really interesting, what that last sentence there. But Zerubbabel,
so they're admitting that they're foreigners, they're not Israelites.
Seems to be, or at least that's what the author of Ezra seems to be, you know, roundaboutly accusing them of. I'm sure that this isn't a direct quote, you know, of something that really happened. It's just...
You said page 299?
Yeah, but just now I was reading from the beginning of Ezra.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
I think a couple of Hangouts ago, Reuven... So that's, you know, you should take that as propaganda, didn't he say?
Yeah, I'm thinking it probably is, but it's interesting that whoever's writing Ezra is saying that, at least from their view, that these people are from Assyria, came to this land from the Assyrians, who brought, it says, from the days of Esarhaddon, the king of Assyria, who brought us up here. So,
okay, because I wasn't sure, because I thought, you know, the most people likely to have a problem with rebuilding in Jerusalem would be remnants of Judahites rather than Samaritans, but I guess not according to the Bible anyway.
By the way, Reuven, even though you reject the idea that the Samaritans are a foreign people, you don't reject the idea that a foreign people did move in to Samaria, would you? And that these are the people that are recorded in the Bible as wanting to join in the building of the temple, and they were rejected.
And do we have? I mean, definitely in the Bible earlier on, we have the records saying that, or the Bible saying that foreign people were brought in. But do we have Assyrian records of that specific importation of foreigners to that specific area? I know as a general policy they would want to do stuff like that, but. Do we have any extra biblical source for that specific importation of foreigners into the northern areas?
I don't know, and I've wondered. I just started wondering today as I was reading this chapter if the whole concept that there were foreigners moved in to Israel was biblical propaganda, in a sense, to vilify northerners and justify, you know, justify Judah's claim to the territory. It didn't really belong to these people that were there. It belonged to them.
Yeah, another interesting aspect of this is in the days of Josiah, how were northerners treated? Because it seems like the book here is arguing that they were trying to integrate, kind of. And obviously they're trying to center it around Jerusalem, but it seemed like they were trying to integrate the two perspectives of the two groups. So I wonder if that division had never really been fully melded, and it was still important culturally, even at this later time, like post-exilic period. So, and I guess Reuben would probably take that line, that because he's, I think he says that's you know, Sumerian, Judite division goes way, way back. I think I've heard him say that before. Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, it's interesting what you said, Dale. It's interesting to, I don't know if we'll ever know, but yeah, it's hard to say.
By the way, that would be the exact opposite of what I remember. John, you've more than once mentioned the possibility that the Jews themselves were never from Palestine until the Persians sent them back and gave them this whole story of, oh yeah, this is your whole history. Whereas this other theory is that nobody who inhabited Palestine was ever imported. This is their home territory. Even the biblical concept that there were an imported people from people imported into the north by the Assyrians may never have actually happened. Is that possible?
Yeah, it's been theorized that, but I'm still inclined to think that the people that returned were the people that left. I don't see any particular reason to necessarily exclude that.
You're talking about the
descendants of the people that left were exiled.
Are you talking about the Jews, or are you talking about, because I'm mentioning the possibility of the northern people not really foreign peoples sent into Israel, but they're just remnants from Israel, the northern kingdom. Is that what you, I apologize, I didn't fully get what you were saying, John. I don't hear anything.
Oh, I'm sorry. what Doug was saying about what the Bible says about those northern people, I think that's not true. I would consider that those people of the north are descendants of the people that remain. They weren't imported in. Or if they were, the ones who were imported in assimilated, and there was no real difference after a certain period of time. The theory about the Judites, I don't really consider it a definite conclusion that they were not the same people that were exiled. I tend to think that they were the same descendants of the same people who were exiled to Babylon, were returned to Judah.
By the way, Reuven makes an interesting point, which I've wondered too. He says, how do you teach a million people a new language and a new identity if the returnees are not natives? And I've wondered too, do we have any inscriptions or writings that are in a foreign tongue in the north to indicate suddenly a huge influx of people that didn't speak Hebrew suddenly enter the land? And how are they suddenly to, as a people, to suddenly learn and embrace a new language as their own? That seems ridiculous.
I wish I knew some books of scholarship on that, but yeah, that, to me, if there was evidence of that, we would probably heard about it.
I have another related question, is how does this all tie in to the creation of the Samaritan Pentateuch, which I still don't have the history of straight in my head yet.
Exactly. That's a great point. I was actually wondering that too, that if the Samaritans were always just Israelites and there was never a foreign people that was sent there, then is this possible that the Samaritan Pentateuch is an earlier version of the Pentateuch, or an earlier strata?
There's a lot of small differences between the two, but I don't think there's any major differences. And you could account for the Samaritan Pentateuch as being adopted or even imposed by the southern returners, say, post-exilic.
The only difference I know of is that the focus from is no longer on Jerusalem, but on Mount Gerizim. So in other words, it just localizes things in their favor.
Yeah, as Reuven says, there's not enough difference. They're, you know, very similar. They're just mainly the value of the Samaritan Pentateuch is for textual criticism because they're basically the same.
Are they linguistically the same too then? So they're both in Hebrew or?
The Samaritans use a different alphabet or something, don't they?
I think they do, and I'm wondering, is that the, I don't know if you call it paleo, you know, the ancient Hebrew script, because the Hebrew script that's used now and in the Dead Sea Scrolls is basically a script that they took, that they adopted from Babylon, this kind of square script that they now have. It's different from the, I don't know if they call it
Proto-Hebrew,
older Hebrew script, yeah. Oh yeah, Reuven mentions the Assyrian square script, yeah. Paleo-Hebrew is what I was thinking of, as he says.
Yeah, and Paleo-Hebrew has a closer relationship to some of the other languages, earlier languages from that region too. More than it does to like cuneiform or something like that.
So the very fact that the Samaritan Pentateuch is still possibly, unless I'm wrong, written in this Paleo-Hebrew script would indicate that they are not a foreign people, you know, that inherited this Assyrian-Babylonian script, but they were people that remained in the land and kept this script.
Well, like Reuven was saying in John, there's still too much. I don't think it could go quite that far back. The text, I mean, if that's what you're meaning. Are you talking about just the script they're using or the text of the Pentateuch?
I'm talking about the script just as an evidence, not necessarily for the early dating of the text they have, but just as an indication to support my theory that they're not a foreign people, that they actually were originally Israelites who lived in the land before the exile and remained in the land.
Yeah, and so what John was saying last hangout and earlier this hangout, that if that's the case, then what we're reading in the Bible about them being foreigners is just propaganda meant to, you know, distance Judahites from them or whatever, you know, whatever the reason.
The other thing is, by bringing up the Samaritan Pentateuch, it might be too late of a document. I was looking on Wikipedia, and they dated 5th century at the earliest, but most likely from, like, the late 2nd century B.C.
The other interesting thing in this chapter was talking about the numbers, possible numbers of the exiles, and who exactly was left behind. And a couple of interesting details I remember was they said that probably about 75% of the population of Judah remained, and about 25% was exiled. And they said, at the page 306 at the bottom of the second paragraph, it says, given these compounded uncertainties, and they're talking about the uncertainties being like some of the two round or perfect numbers in the Second Kings and Jeremiah and stuff like that about the numbers. The most that can be reasonably said is that we are dealing with a total number of exiles ranging between a few thousand and perhaps 15 and 20,000 at most. When we compare this number to the total population of Judah in the late 7th century before the destruction of Jerusalem, we can gain an idea of the scale of the deportations. Judah's population can be quite accurately estimated from data collected during intensive surveys and excavations at about 75,000. So that's for Judah. And just in Jerusalem, there about 20% of that 75,000, it was just in Jerusalem. So that would mean at least 75% of the population remained on the land. So, like, one of the numbers given in 2 Kings was, I think, 46,000. That's obviously, according to these guys, that's way too big. Like, double the most liberal archaeological estimate.
That still leaves open the question of the demographic differences in who they took versus who they left. I mean, you'd probably assume they'd leave a lot of the older people, so anybody, you know, 50, 60 years old might have probably, unless they're really experts in certain fields, would probably have been left. You know, maybe all the young children probably been left, but, you know, would they have taken mostly males, or would they have taken an even mix of males and females? And that's another question.
And, well, exactly, and that was the other thing they mentioned.
So my guess would be they've taken mostly middle-aged males, but I don't know for sure if that's true or not.
It's a good possibility. And the other thing they mentioned was that they may have done this count of the male of just males. This may have been a count of just the males. And if that's the case, then the Second Kings number is even way more inflated. Actually, it would end up being bigger than the entire population of Judah if you'd throw in, you know, women and children. That adds another, like, 70% on, if it's just males, add on another 70% to that number, at least.
So it seems that that what they're saying is that what the Babylonians did is exactly what the Assyrians did. They only took nobles and skilled tradesmen that they could use. I mean, I don't see any real difference. They left the majority in the land.
Between the Assyrian and Babylonian, you're talking about?
Yeah, the Assyrians took only some that they wanted, and also the nobles, so that they no longer could rule the land, you know, and they installed their own rulership or whatever, just like the Babylonians put Gedaliah in place. But other than that, they only took the ones that they wanted, and then I guess this whole concept of basically the land emptying out during the exile is either, I often wonder, did I just read it wrong, or is it, or is the Bible actually gave that idea and it was just a misleading concept?
The other question I have on demographics is, did they mainly take individuals to move, or did they actually just take nuclear families to move or something? I mean, do they split up families routinely during this exploitation or not?
I'd be surprised if they split up families.
I don't know. I'm just asking what you guys think. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm trying to find something from an earlier chapter about the Assyrian exile. But
sorry that I have more questions than answers on these things.
That's okay. I have the same thing. Reuben says it would explain the mixed marriages if they didn't allow them to bring their wives, or few women were taken. What do you mean, Reuben? Because it seems like there was a preoccupation to not have mixed marriages during the return.
Among the Jews, yeah, but I mean, among the Babylonians who are in charge of the exportation, if they took just males, and the males who end up in Babylon, you know, may end up marrying new wives there.
Oh, I see what you're saying. So there were a lot of mixed marriages between the exiled Jewish males and native Babylonian women. Is that what you're saying?
Waiting on Reuben to confirm.
By the way, that makes me question, maybe you're talking about this too, but this theory that I'm like trying to think through, then the idea that there were no foreigners brought to the land of Israel, there was this issue repeatedly faced by Nehemiah and Ezra of mixed marriages, that is, of Jews marrying foreigners in the land of Israel. Who are these foreigners if no foreigners were ever brought into the land?
Well, they weren't. That's the propaganda.
So is it just a forbidding of Jews to marry Israel? Jews from the south to marry Israelites from the north?
That would be part of it, seems like.
I think it's also a blanket term. The people of the land also includes people that are still there, I think. Judahites.
People that had remained.
Yeah.
Well, returning exiles, not marrying the people that remain.
Yeah. That's what I think. And to make them out to be foreigners, I think, is not only propaganda concerning the North, but also propaganda concerning the people that remain in Judah.
Is this a way of elevating the people that return so that they can, because they ended up ruling over the locals who remained?
Yeah, and I think it's the source of the distinctiveness of Judaism, the tendency to want to be distinct comes from this.
It is surprising, though, that that they would want to be distinct from their own people. In other words,
reasons would be, because they've taken on Canaanite ways as opposed to the true, pure Judaism that's being returned to them.
I can see that.
And consequently, your marriages with pagan idolaters is making you unclean, so best to get rid of them.
By the way, this idea that they've been tainted by remaining, I could certainly see that the Bible's account indicates that they end up going into Egypt, and so they're influenced by Egyptian religion, because you remember the story, basically, is that the Babylonians set up this ruler, Gedaliah, but then he's murdered, and out of fear, everyone who's remaining in the land, out of fear that the Babylonians are going to punish them, they all decide to head down to Egypt, including Jeremiah.
You would think that a lot of people would head to Egypt even during the Babylonian destruction period, too, not necessarily just after. Who knows?
Here's what I was looking for. And we did talk about this, but I guess we all forgot it. Remember, we were talking about in the Bible the mention of the importation of foreigners into the north after the Assyrians conquered. And I thought, I could have swore there was some extra biblical evidence, and there is. On page 217, this is Sargon from Sargon's Chronicles. He says, I formed a unit with 200, I'm just going from the middle on page 220. I formed a unit with 200 of their chariots for my royal force. I settled the rest of them in the midst of Assyria, so that's the exile. I repopulated Samaria more than before. I brought into it people from countries conquered by my hands. I appointed my commissioner as governor over them, and I counted them as Assyrians. So he's saying, obviously, he brought in administrators, but he's also saying I repopulated Samaria more than before. I brought into it people from countries conquered by my hand. So he seems like, at least from Sargon's Chronicles, he not only brought in as administrators, but also seems like vast numbers of people that from other conquered people. So that's interesting. We've got the biblical account, which may or may not be propaganda, but we've also got something from the conqueror himself saying he did it too.
Yeah, Finkelstein was mentioning Silberman was mentioning that that's one of the contrasts between the Assyrians and the Babylonians, is that the Assyrians, when they exported people, would take people from elsewhere to replace them, to basically keeping the overall populations kind of the same, but the Babylonians didn't do that. They just exported people, and that was it.
That was one of the arguments that some scholars point out to say that, the returners from Babylon, why would the Persians be so much different than the Assyrians? It's just that we don't have a stela or something like that that says that, yes, Cyrus relocated people from all over the place and sent them there, It's an assumption that they didn't do it simply because it's not mentioned and the Bible makes it out as appears not that way. But can we really for sure say that that's true?
Good point, John.
By the way, John, do you know who presents that theory? I've been wondering. I don't even know how to look that up in the internet.
Geez, I could probably find out real quick for you. I can't think of it offhand, though.
Yeah, if you can find that, I'd love to read more about that. By the way, Doug, so that quote, I'm just going to take that as a way of something that shoots my theory down. I don't think I can hold it in the light of that.
No, I think it supports your theory. Because you're saying that, if I'm understanding you right, you're saying that that there were actually foreigners brought into the north after the Assyrians conquered it, right?
Well, I was starting to wonder if there never was, if it never did happen.
I got you.
You know, especially because of Reuven's idea that the Samaritans were Israelites, and so I was starting to think if that's the case, then maybe there never were foreign people brought into the land, and this whole... Like, you know, I read Reuven's comment, basically, that how do you get suddenly millions of people, a million people, whatever, I don't imagine there were a million, but how do you get this giant influx of people suddenly to learn a new language as their native language and, you know, change their religion and everything?
Well, it wouldn't necessarily have been sudden. I mean, we have populations moving about even today that slowly over many generations integrate into the host society. So the same thing could have happened. And remember, this is at a time when the North, the kingdom of the North and the organization and everything, it basically was gone at that point. So these foreigners, you know, if this is true, and I think we can be somewhat confident at least that it happened, since we've got Sargon telling us he did it, and then we've got the Bible telling us he did it too.
Right.
So two independent sources saying it happened. As far as the exact number of people that he imported, I don't know, but it seems to say he brought a lot in, because he's saying he repopulated even more than already had been.
Do you think this, what Reuven says about, I'm just thinking through the DNA question, it seems to me that, do you think it's possible to think that when these people came and they intermarried, which is obviously must have been going on because of Ezra and Nehemiah criticizing it, the practice, that through this intermarriage that they became indistinguishable from Israelites, so that DNA tests would show that, yeah, they're the same people now. But they were foreigners at the beginning, but now they've integrated so much you can't tell the difference.
Well, who knows? I mean, the other thing I didn't really want to mention it last time because it's a whole other issue, but some of these DNA tests of ancestry, especially when you get this specific different population groups within a tiny region like this, they're not like paternity tests. I mean, they're not that clear cut. I mean, they can give you a good idea of when things definitely don't fit your model. But a lot of them, depending on like how many spots in the genome they're looking at, it's not clear cut all the time. So there could have been some interbreeding of neighboring populations that Sargon had conquered, brought into Samaria. These people could have bred with the natives, and today we're doing DNA tests, and depending on how specific you want to get, you could say that, you know, they're different from Judahites, say, or different from native Sumerians, but the problem is our sample of native Sumerians would include those foreign populations if they had interbred to a large extent. So it's hard to say, from my opinion, on DNA.
Yeah, from what I know about DNA tests, it mixes so thoroughly after even like 20 generations, the DNA has so much little left from a single ancestor that, I don't know, I don't see how it's useful that far back.
Yeah, my problem, especially when you're trying to get that specific about it, I think in broad terms it's useful for like saying, okay, this is obviously Asian ancestry, this is, say, Caucasian, this is African, this is, you know, whatever, that, it's useful for that. That they can almost predict, like, almost 99% of the time on that. But when you really get specific into these tons of different population groups in a tiny little region, I don't have much confidence in it. But that's just my opinion. I'm not an expert, so...
I still am intrigued by the effect that the Samaritan Pentateuch is written in a Proto-Hebrew script and not the Assyrian script that a foreign people would have brought into the land with them.
Yeah, it kind of supports the theory that they're a continuous population. They went right from the Proto-Hebrew script into a later script with no importation of Aramaic script.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Well, do we have Proto-Hebrew from the north, from before the Assyrian conquest to compare it to?
Like the Lakish letters? No, where that was Judah, I guess.
Yeah.
I couldn't name any, but I'm sure there is.
Because like the early Hebrew like looks a lot like Phoenician and stuff like that. So obviously there's influence there, but I don't know if. That's way too early, probably, for that to...
Actually, when I say Proto-Hebrew, I probably am... That probably could be called the Phoenician script, I imagine. By the way, the Tel Dan inscription that refers to the House of David, what script was that in?
I think it was in Proto-Hebrew. Pretty sure.
Can I read something from Wikipedia? I don't know how reliable it is, but it's there, and I just want to read it.
On Wiki, it's got to be true.
It says, the script of the Samaritan Pentateuch has close connections at many points with the Septuagint, and has even closer agreements with the present Hebrew text. All suggest a date about 122 BCE.
Yeah, because it's... They date it quite late because of its similarities to the Septuagint as far as a textual family goes.
Although it seems to me that that's somewhat backward thinking because, or at least it presumes something, that the text of the Septuagint started when it was translated and doesn't reflect an earlier text. Because there are many scholars that think that the Septuagint reflects an earlier text than we have in the Masoretic Hebrew text.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it does, even for parts of Genesis at least. I'm not an expert on it, but just from my own reading and textual variance, the Septuagint always seems to have the what looks to me as most original.
So in other words, if the Samaritan Pentateuch agrees with the Greek Septuagint, that indicates to me that the Samaritan Pentateuch then is an earlier text than the one that we have in the Masoretic text. It reflects a tradition.
We don't know how far back the Septuagint's underlying text goes back.
Yeah.
That's why they're saying it's that late date, is because, well, we know the Septuagint was probably written around 200 and some BC. So there has to be a period of time after that that the Samaritan Pentateuch then came into use. So...
But let me give my argument here. Okay. In the previous Hangouts, I shared with you my chart regarding the form of Genesis 1 and how the different days of creation have a certain form critical block to them. With the Septuagint text, one of two things has to be true. Either the text is older than the Masoretic text and represents a more original account of that story, or somebody else historically saw the same patterns I was seeing and edited the Septuagint to make them fit those patterns.
I got lost in there.
The Septuagint fits the forms in the creation story more logically than the Masoretic text does.
On
the second day, it has the, you know, it was good, which the Masoretic text is lacking, but it should be for the other days. But there's other things in there also. There's like three places where the Septuagint has a text that looks more original than the Masoretic text for Genesis 1. And the only explanations I can have for that is either the Septuagint text is the earlier text, or somebody else saw the same patterns that I was seeing and edited the text to fix the patterns.
And that's a possibility too. we run into the same problems talking about gospel traditions. So how many times were they edited and cross-edited against each other before our earliest manuscripts? Who knows?
Yeah, but when they say that the Samaritan Pentateuch is even more similar to the Masoretic text than it even is the Septuagint, even if the Septuagint was earlier, that sometime immediately after it was translated into Greek, that Hebrew text was possibly revised and also around the same time went north, too. So yeah. It doesn't have to be a very long time. It could all take place within a relatively short period of time. But you can't really say how old the Septuagint text is. You can only say the terminal ad quem, I believe it is. I think that's the right one, right word.
Yeah, I like terminus ad quem. I like what Ruben put in the side chat. I don't know if I'm missing an earlier comment. Let me check before I read it. No. He says the Samaritan Pentateuch uses less anthropomorphic language and descriptions of God with intermediaries performing actions. The Masoretic version attributes directly to God, where the Masoretic describes Yahweh as a man of war, Exodus 15:3, the Samaritan has hero of war, a phrase applied to spiritual beings, and in Numbers 23:4, the Samaritan reading, the angel of God found Balaam, contrasts with the Masoretic, and God met Balaam. And I'm not an expert. My own opinion seems to be that the Samaritan version seems more ancient to me there.
Yeah, it has the more difficult readings to use New Testament terminology, textual criticism terminology.
I agree with you, Wayne. I think that's true.
So...
How is that more difficult?
Well, I mean, yeah, I guess it's not more difficult. I guess you're right, because it's... Because, I got mixed up there. The anthropomorphic would be more... would seem to be more primitive, if you want to call it that. God more directly interacting rather than through an intermediary. So, yeah, I got that mixed up. Sorry.
But then there's also evidence that they're changing... A text, you know, they're finding to their sensibilities, so that would make the Samaritan text derivative.
Would it necessarily?
I'm not saying that from what Ruben quoted.
Well, you know, if the Masoretic text says God met Balaam, it seems to me that that's taken as, you know, somehow offensive to the Samaritans, so they then modified it to the angel of God found Balaam. To me, that's like an apologetic correction according to their own theology.
Yeah, I'm with you there. I think that's right, yeah.
And it seems like, and God met Balaam would be more primitive to me anyway. And just that's just those specific examples. There could be others that might not be so clear-cut.
Yeah, I agree with you on those examples. Reminding me of Gunkel. Same type of thing.
I think I read it wrong, so I think I actually, yeah, I think I switched. I think the Masoretic does seem more primitive. I read it wrong, what we were going to grow.
Let me get back to, I'm trying to flip 12. I didn't really take notes for this reading. I'm trying to look at the sub-chapter sections and just remember. Oh, yeah, we talked about those who remained. The other thing was that it seems like, you know, Judah, the kingdom of Judah basically crumbles. We've got Jehoiakim, again, if I'm saying that right, I don't know, surviving. So the lineage of David is intact, at least from him, for a little bit. But it seems like they're... Finkelstein and Silberman are saying that during the exile, it seems like the priests and the return, the priests really kind of supplanted the position of the kings as being like the primary power, I guess you'd say, of Judah after the return. So, and during the exile, it seems like too.
Yeah, which is interesting. He mentions that when Zerubbabel is governor, he is a descendant of David, and yet after Yeah, he's never king. He's never made king, and he's also suddenly disappears after they rebuild the temple.
Right.
And so he thinks Zerubbabel may have been recalled back to Persia. But all he, but basically his main case is that he thinks there may have been intentional, intentionally kept the seed of David from returning to Israel, so that they had no claim, they had no rightful claims to the throne, to keep the people away from trying to establish a kingship again.
Yeah, because they said they feared messianic hopes. Yeah.
It all sounded very suspicious to me. I mean, that somebody, to me, it sounds like they're fictional characters. They perform their part and then they're removed from the narrative.
Could be, yeah. I mean, seems like some of the history we're dealing with in the Deuteronomistic history, like we said, from the time of like the Omrides, from Omri, it seems like we're starting to get into an agreement between archaeology and some of the stuff said in the Bible. But yeah, definitely some of these characters and a lot of these events are still seem to be propaganda or myth or legendary or whatever, you know. So yeah, who knows? But you're right, John, I agree, that's speculative for sure. But it would make sense, too, like, that they wouldn't want to give back the lineage of King David. Considering the importance of that line, they wouldn't want to return someone like that or leave him in place in Judah for fear of, like, a resurgence of a rebellious attitude, you know, developing again. So, but who knows?
Well, we would have to also accept that the Babylonians only really cared about killing the direct descendants of the kings, but just left a great deal of the royal family alive, or even a distant really related somebody, you know, a prince who might not have been, you know, particularly close to the line of succession, could just come along and, you know, try to reestablish a Davidic kingdom under mm-hmm. the nose of the Persians. It just, to me, all that sounds pretty forced, that there was even a Davidic line left.
Oh, that's very interesting. So it could have been wiped out in Babylon, but they only create a character of Zerubbabel just to say that the line has survived.
Yeah, that was my suspicious mind thinking.
But then you got to ask, like, why would they want to do that? Just to give a better, like, origin to the temple building, saying, oh, it was built, even though the line of David's gone, at least it was. Our new temple at least was built by a descendant of David.
It could have been.
At least to keep the hope alive of a Davidic line.
Yeah.
Because they're anticipating the New Testament.
Yeah, so obviously.
Yeah. The Persians couldn't have killed off any of the ancestors of Jesus, obviously. Or the direct line ancestors. At least not before they had kids.
I believe this is probably the time when messianic hopes began. I don't know if you guys suspect the concept of a messiah started. I've heard some indicate that it's a Persian concept, a Zoroastrian concept that the Jews adopted. And if it never existed in earlier times and they took it from the Persians, then here's the beginnings, you know, of this hope that we have a returning king, that all these prophecies of a seed of David, which possibly may have been designed for Josiah, if they weren't fulfilled in him, then we have at least this idea that there's still somebody one day who is going to fulfill these prophecies.
Yeah, they had to keep that hope alive. But obviously, practically at the time, they had to rely on the priesthood because there were possibly no Davidic heirs left, as John says. Reuben says, Ezra begins with Cyrus the Great entrusting the temple vessels to Sheshbazar, or Sheshbazar, I don't know how you say that, modern Sheshbatsar, Tiberian Sesbassar, prince of Judah. This apparently important figure then disappears from the story entirely. Ezra chapter 1, 8, verse 8 and 11, and Zerubbabel is abruptly introduced as the main figure. Both are called governors of Judah and are both credited with laying the foundation of the temple. A number of explanations have been posited, including 1, the two are the same person, 2, Sheshbazzar was in fact Shenazar, Zerubbabel's uncle, mentioned in Chronicles, or 3, Sheshbazzar began the work and Zerubbabel finished it. Mashach, or Messiah, appears many times before Cyrus, but Moshiach is apparently from the Persian period. Do they mean same thing, Reuben, basically?
So they carry off the temple treasure, and then they still keep the stuff laying around? They didn't bother melting it down? They just have all the temple treasure just waiting to go back to the temple someday?
My guess is no. I'd say that's probably bullshit.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing when I read it, too. Yeah, why didn't they melt this stuff down?
I think they remade it all, probably.
Or it was donated. You know, it's probably just a bunch of Ahura Mazda statues going in there.
Yeah. Nehushtan poles and Asherahs.
Yeah, whatever they're laying around.
Yeah.
You don't think it's reasonable to think that they deposited the holy utensils from that were used in the worship of different gods and deposited in the temple of their god?
Maybe some trophies, but geez, if you had to have a whole temple to hold one treasure, you're going to need a really big one.
Okay, so that's the bulk of chapter 12. Kind of went over each of the major sections. One other quick thing was, about the priestly source. Yeah, they're saying that the priestly source and the final redaction of the Pentateuch, they date to roughly the same period. And they talk about like some of the people returning from exile would have kind of seen the story of Exodus as like similar to their plight, I think they said. You know, they're stuck in a foreign land, they have to come back, they're strangers in their land, they have to retake it, blah, 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 blah. So that was interesting. Yeah, both were surrounded by alien hostile neighbors, both claimed nearby territories that were outside their realm. Both faced problems with foreigners from within and without and were concerned with the questions of the purity of the community and assimilation. That's Exodus and Return from Exile.
They also mention that it's the peace source that first creates the concept of Abraham as coming from Ur of the Chaldeans.
Right. Trying to give him a more respectable pedigree, because I guess that was a well-known, highly advanced cosmopolitan city, I guess. So, anything else on chapter 12? You guys want to move into the...
Let me here's my understanding, and then you guys tell me if this is what you understand. Then, as far as this is like summing up then what we know about the documentary hypothesis, that the J and E sources are the oldest sources of text, both coming from before the time of Hezekiah. The J source from the southern kingdom of Judah, and the E source from the northern kingdom of Israel, and then the D source is written, the first, at least, layer during the time of Josiah.
Or possibly a little before.
And then the second stage, possibly during or after the exile. And then the peace source is written after the exile. Is that right?
That's what they seem to be arguing. Yeah.
Okay.
So wait, so given my earlier question, if the P source is post-exilic, we'd be more likely to see parts of P in the Deuteronomic history then, in those books.
Well, some scholars put P, you know, earlier because they did have the Solomonic Temple. You know, that's supposedly where these P guys are at when they're first at.
Yeah, I'm just still wondering about the question of whether there's supposed to be P source material in books of the Bible outside the Pentateuch.
You're going to have to do that, Wayne.
Yep, I don't know.
You're going to have to write that book.
So the epilogue, I don't think we really need to delve into it. It's just kind of summarizing what happened with Israel after, I mean, eventually Alexander conquers, then you've got Alexander dies, then you got the Ptolemies and the Seleucids fighting over that region of Palestine, then eventually the Romans come in after the Hasmonean kings end up squabbling or whatever, they basically die out. And, we know the rest of the story, so that's kind of seemed like what it was dealing with. And then it talked a little bit about how during the 19th century, I'm sorry, was it 18th century? I guess so. Basically, I want to say Reformation, but that's not the right word. The Enlightenment period, scholars sort of trying to look to the Bible for information about the history, like true facts history, and that's when we begin to find problems with it, and we get books like this. Anything else on the epilogue that you guys want to talk about or read? Pretty straightforward.
Yeah, nothing.
Yeah, okay. What did you guys think of the appendices for those that managed to read it? I thought they were interesting, for sure.
Just like I said,
more detail on some of these different theories.
I thought they were interesting and well-written, yeah. Some of them I thought was almost funny in a way, like when he's talking about the location of Mount Sinai. He doesn't even bother trying to argue against it archaeologically. His entire argument is that the people who are claiming that this mountain is Mount Sinai have nothing to go on, and that's all we care about. They're full
right.
of shit, and that's it.
And that was Appendix C, right?
B, yeah.
And, yeah, I guess that some 6th century monastery was built at the foot of this mountain.
St. Catherine's Monastery?
Yeah. And they're just saying this is just tradition. It was a convenient, beautiful location to put a monastery. It was near a big mountain. It's scenic. You're able to live there or set up a monastery there. So, hey, why not say this is Mount Sinai and this is the area in the Sinai where Moses wandered?
Yeah.
You know,
the best I can say about that is that I think the story of the Exodus is actually fiction. But the author of the fiction certainly had, you know, certain regions of mountains, at least, if not a specific mountain in mind. So this is, you know, very likely the right region, then, that the author of the Exodus was talking about, but it's still fictional.
Yeah, like the Exodus takes place in a historical setting. It doesn't take place in like primordial history and region.
Exactly, yeah. So this sounds, you know, reasonably like what the author may have had in mind, but that's the closest we can get.
Right. The first appendix was about, the patriarchal age, and they talked about a bunch of different theories. Some people trying to place them in, like, the middle bronze or the intermittent bronze age, which was, it was between two periods of heavy urbanized periods, where you'd have, like, developed cities or towns, whatever you want to call them. And then there's this intermediate period of a couple hundred years that people wanted to place, okay, here's where the patriarchs were, because in the story of the Bible, the patriarchs don't seem to be wandering around like an urbanized setting. So, and a lot of the cities that we know to have been urbanized in those two sandwich periods, bookend periods to this intermediate period, they were cities, but in the Bible they're really just not even mentioned to be cities. Or you have the other problem where they're mentioned to be cities, but they weren't yet. So that was one of the periods they mentioned. Then they tried to place some, what was the other place? The fall of the Bronze Age or Iron Age 1. Basically, different theories of when they could have been, like trying to figure out what's the historical setting for these stories of the patriarchs. And they basically go over lots of anachronistic problems, lack of archaeological evidence, or direct contradiction by archaeological evidence.
Basically, none of the three major theories works in the opinion of Finkelstein and Silberman.
Right, you can't place them in history.
Yeah,
but they haven't all gone away, because I think a few Hangouts ago I mentioned one video guy I saw on YouTube was still talking about the Amorite theory, some revision of it. So, you know, that stuff doesn't exactly go away like maybe Finkelstein and Silberman kind of allude to.
Well, I think part of the purpose of these appendices is that Finkelstein and Silberman realized they didn't necessarily address earlier in the book a lot of the other theories that are going around, and figure they need to say something about them, you know, and give readers a bit of reference. You know, if we're reading William Deaver's book later on, you know, we can go back and check this appendix to remember why Finkelstein and Silberman don't agree with Deaver's theory.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Then there was Appendix C dealt with alternative theories of the conquest of Israel and kind of who were the Israelites, where did they come from. It dealt with the peaceful infiltration theory, which was basically like Bedouin-type people who eventually started trying to become a little more sedentary and started conflicting with the already fully settled surrounding populations, and came in conflict and then eventually kind of formed their separate identity. It dealt with peasant revolt, which dealt with I don't remember exactly on this one. Basically,
ideology. They needed a competing ideology against Canaanite religion, which to me sounds like, you know, monotheism and that kind of stuff seems like advanced concepts. You know, not something that people would do as a reactionary ideology.
Yeah, it has to evolve in its own.
Yeah, and the basis of the basis of the theory was that you'd have, during this time, you'd have, and I think this is proposed to be in the end of the Late Bronze Age, so right at that general collapse, I think. But, you'd have these city-states, kind of, or whatever you want to call them. Like, you'd have a city, and it governed the rural villages surrounding it, and all the agricultural land surrounding it, and you'd have these
called a feudal system.
Yeah, exactly. And eventually you'd have these peasants who were, I forget why they said they wanted to revolt. I don't remember that. What
I think it's just to get better freedom and economic circumstances, I think.
Yeah, possibly.
It's more personal control of their wealth.
Yeah, it's like Protestantism.
I like the last paragraph of this appendix. Just how succinctly he puts it.
Yeah.
All three theories of the Israelite conquest, unified invasion, peaceful infiltration, and social revolution, endorse the pivotal biblical notion that the rise of early Israel was a unique, singular phenomenon in the history of the country. New discoveries of recent decades have shattered that idea.
Yeah, and that was the last one, too, the social revolution theory that, this one, in the specific formulation that they're arguing against, I can see the problems with it that they mention. Although that kind of does seem, in a way, you could argue that is kind of what they're arguing earlier on when they're talking about what we read, their theory that you had these path people shifting between pastoralism and settled agrarian life and trading with the surrounding cities, and eventually in the highlands they start differentiating themselves. We start finding at a certain point layers no longer contain pig bones, etc. But these people were Canaanites, and they eventually, through slow evolution rather than revolution, so I guess that's a difference, differentiated from the surrounding bigger cities and, you know, surrounding peoples in different regions of Israel.
A lot of these theories seem to reflect the historical period of time that they were thought up. You know, different types of ideologies come into vogue in history, modern history. So, you know, when there was a lot of leftist ideology post-World War II influencing all kinds of scholarship, there was a tendency to see things in terms of social revolutions and things like that. So when you look at all three theories, you could see the ideologies in effect shining through, to me anyway.
Yeah.
That kind of localized them in a modern historical period.
Mm-hmm. So anything else from those appendices? Or do you guys want to talk about Appendix D? That was kind of a short one, too.
They're all fairly short.
Yeah. Well, basically, Appendix D was going a little more in depth to the details of the datings of the... and some of the archaeological evidence relating to the Davidic and Solomonic period, basically. And the more of the problems with some of the traditional uses of archaeological evidence to validate the biblical story. Appendix E, identifying the era of Manasseh in the archaeological record, super short. Again, just kind of a summary of some of the archaeological evidence that they're using to nail that down. Anything to say on D&E by anybody? No? Okay, so Appendix F, second to last one, dealt with, it's called How Vast Was the Kingdom of Josiah, and basically that. I mean, they're going over more archaeological evidence, looking at some of the cities, basically questioning, like, how far exactly was Josiah able to expand the kingdom of Judah, essentially? What cities did he control or work to rebuild? And actually, the last paragraph is a good summary for this appendix. Anyone want to read it? Page 353. It just summarizes, like, all the different issues they tackled. Oh, sorry. Go ahead with D, Wayne.
Yeah. One thing he brings up in Appendix D is that the dating of the Solomonic Kingdom, from the standard view, it's based on a single verse in the Bible. He mentions that. In 1 Kings 19:5, on page 342, he says, yeah. It is clear, therefore, the whole idea of the archaeology of the United Monarchy, of the blueprint city planning of Solomon's architects, of the grandeur of the Solomonic palaces, rests on one verse in the Bible, 1 Kings 9:15. We must repeat this again. The entire traditional reconstruction of the nature of the United Monarchy of Israel, its territorial expansion, its material culture, its relationship with the neighboring countries, depends on the interpretation of a single biblical verse. And this verse is quite problematic because we do not know if it is based on authentic sources from the time of Solomon or later realities. We do not even understand its exact meaning. Does built mean Solomon founded new cities? Does it only mean he fortified existing ones? Do the three cities mentioned, Megiddo, Gezer, and Hazor, merely symbolize for the Othniel kings the three main administrative cities of northern Israel? Did the author of Kings project the great construction in these cities into later years, back into the days of Solomon?
Which is what they're arguing, that last proposition.
Yeah, if you read it, you can understand why there's a confusion, because it just says, this is the account of the forced labor that King Solomon conscripted to build the house of the Lord and his own house, the Millo, and the wall of Jerusalem, Hazor, Megiddo, and Gezer.
Yeah. And then what translation were you reading, by the way, John?
New Revised Standard Version.
Okay. One, just a real quick aside, the NASB or the NRSV, I don't think do this, but the Lexham keeps the names of God, so Yahweh. I don't know if it actually keeps Elohim, or does anyone know of a translation that keeps all those names, doesn't replace them with Lord or Most High?
Not really popular translations, and I know there are a bunch that do keep them, but there's translations used by so-called Messianic Jews and stuff that we'll keep those.
Okay.
There's also another paragraph here I wanted to read, just the end of this appendix. A word should be said here about the treatment of the biblical materials. Some of our colleagues wonder how we can dismiss the historicity of one verse in the Bible, 1 Kings 9:15, and accept the historicity of others, relating to Ahab's construction of the palace at Jezreel, 1 Kings 21:1. And to the construction of the palace at Samaria by Omri, 1 Kings 16:24. The answer has to do with methodology. The biblical material cannot be treated as a monolithic block. It does not require a take-all or leave-all attitude. Two centuries of modern biblical scholarship have shown us that the biblical material must be evaluated chapter by chapter and sometimes verse by verse. The Bible includes historical, non-historical, and quasi-historical materials, which sometimes appear very close to one another in the text. The whole essence of biblical scholarship is to separate the historical parts from the rest of the text according to linguistic, literary, and extra-biblical historical considerations. So yes, one may doubt the historicity of one verse and still accept the validity of another, especially in the case of Omri and Ahab, whose kingdom is described in contemporary Assyrian, Moabite, and Aramean texts.
Yep. Does it agree with archaeology?
Yeah, I really like that paragraph, though, so I wanted to have it part of the live hangout here.
Yeah, that is a great paragraph, and it really deals, like it says, with the methodological approach to critically analyzing the Bible. So, yeah. So we did Appendix E, we did talk to anything you guys wanted to mention on Appendix F, because I wanted to read, or someone can read, the last paragraph of Appendix F, which I think sums it up pretty well. The conclusion of the argument, I should say. Anyone want to read it, or have anything to say about that appendix as a whole? How vast is the kingdom of Josiah? Because this appendix, to me, was like a real question. This is a real problem in archaeology, just how vast it was.
I'll read it.
Okay.
It says, when all these items are individually plotted on a map, their distribution is quite similar. It extends from the Beersheba Valley to the plateau of Bethel, north of Jerusalem, and from the Dead Sea and Jordan Valley to the upper Shephelah. The question is, were these the borders of Judah, and do they indicate that there was no expansion farther to the north, or do they represent only the core territory of the kingdom? In this case, too, we must remember that if the drive to the north was short-lived, it could be underrepresented in the archaeological record, but a permanent and far-reaching annexation of new territories into the kingdom of Judah is simply not suggested by the archaeological finds.
Yeah, which I thought was interesting because, remember, I think it was last hangout we were talking about Who is the pharaoh that killed Josiah?
Necho or something? Or
yeah, Necho, yeah.
Necho.
Maybe it's Necho, I'm not sure how you say it. Necho the second. Thank you, Reuben. One of the theories, you know, they presented a few theories. One I thought was interesting was that he was kind of expanding a little too much and had to be done away with because he was becoming a threat, essentially. That was the one I favored to be most likely, but a few were given, which, and it relates to this the last question in this paragraph, like exactly how far-reaching was Judah. But then they go on to say there's no direct archaeological evidence that, like, they were really that far-reaching, but makes you wonder about exactly what happened with Necho the second and Josiah. So, and anything else on F? Okay, so G, the last appendix. About a page long total.
Reuben has more on F.
Oh, he does. He does? Oh, I got more on FU.
Oh, I didn't catch what you were saying. I'm sorry. I didn't realize it was a joke. I thought we were waiting for him to type something else.
So, he's Appendix G. Sorry, John?
I said Reuben's the king of pho.
Yeah. The last appendix G, boundaries of the province of Yehud. And remember, this is the name given to this region, I think they said by the Persians, or at least adopted at that period of time. And that's when we get the term Jewish, Jew, from Yehud. So, and
that
again...
Can I throw another question in here? Is it just a coincidence that the word Hebrew and Hebron for the city sound so similar, or is there a relationship between them?
I'm not sure. Because Hebron was that one of the Philistine cities, or am I getting mixed up? Reuben? Reuben will know. I think it wasn't, but I'm not sure.
You're not kidding. Okay.
Hebron was not one of the Philistine cities. No,
it wasn't. There were like six or seven of them, right?
Five cities, and it was an important city in Judah. And I think they were talking about how it was an embarrassment that the Edomites took over that region.
Yeah, and that was when did that happen? After Judah fell.
Exactly.
Yeah.
When the Babylonians ruled.
Yeah.
Anyway, I didn't mean to make Doug lose his train of thought or anything. I just wanted to ask.
Oh, don't sweat it. So yeah, last appendix, boundaries of the province of Yehud. So that's where that name comes from. And again, it's just kind of talking about what were the boundaries of that region, essentially, of that political region, essentially. So anything you guys want to talk about from that really short final appendix? It does say, like, it was divided up into provinces, and it says the textual reconstruction of the boundaries of the province of Yehud is confirmed by archaeological finds. The most indicative of these are various seal impressions found on pottery vessels from the Persian period bearing Aramaic and Hebrew characters that spell out the Aramaic name of the province, Yehud. A few hundred examples have so far been found. Their distribution, at least in meaningful quantities, is identical to the boundaries of the province of Yehud as described above. And this is mainly coming from Nehemiah, these descriptions of the boundaries. Anyway, yeah, so just a little short blurb on that, essentially.
One thing that Nehemiah
in general agrees with the archaeological evidence.
One thing that catches me in how specific Finkelstein and Silberman are in switching between using the term Judah and using the term Yehud, are they equally specific when they use the term Israelite? Because it seems like they're talking about Israelite all through this book in a way that the meaning seems to change.
Because this is the time during the Persian era where it did change.
Yeah.
Because before Yehud was around, they were just Israelites. And then...
Or just this, Judeans, you mean? Or...
Yeah, or Judeans refers to just the southern...
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know, because I guess I've heard that Israelites can refer to Israelites, as in from the north, and even can be used more generally just to describe the northern and southern people. Ancient Israelites.
Until this point, they've been using the phrase Judahites to refer right. to people from the southern kingdom, so they have not been using the term Israelites in general. I think, I don't know for sure, but I had the impression that they were restricting that to the people from the northern kingdom.
I think in a couple of places they did use the more general use, just referring to like ancient Israelites as, you know.
Yeah. It struck me as inconsistent with how specific they're being about using Yehud and Judah.
And I was surprised, like you, to see this use of the phrase Yehud, because I just assumed Yehud was... Well, I assumed that it was the phrase Yehuda is just another phrase of Judah. In other words, to start... I guess anybody that's really picky or particular about insisting on the Hebrew pronunciation, like I would... Until this point, he's been using the anglicized form. So, in other words, for us to still say Judah would be natural, or Judea, let's say, would be natural. I don't know why suddenly he wants to say Yehud.
Yeah.
Let me read something from the end of chapter 12.
By the way, Reuben says Yehud equals Judea, not Judah.
Yeah, that's why Judah was referred. The occupants of Judah refer as Judahites early on, before...
Just southern.
Yeah.
Right. So Judah specifically refers to the southern kingdom, whereas Judea refers to the whole, I guess.
Post-exile.
Post-exile, good point.
Oh, yeah, so...
And as Reuben says, that's... They're starting to use that phrase because the Persians are the ones that use that phrase. I guess so. The Persians are the very first ones who ever used that phrase, and it
right.
became the common phrase until I guess the Romans used the term Palestine, which basically is so. Judea has Judah in mind, whereas when the Romans used the term Palestine, they actually had Philistia in mind, the Philistines.
Yeah, because they consciously wanted to name the territory after different people from the Jews.
Yeah, that's very interesting.
Interesting book on your slideshow, John. Another one.
Oh, yeah.
And by the way, Reuben's mentioning also that they... So what you've mentioned, John, as far as their intentional decision to make sure it wasn't named after the previous Judea, but... Palestine. So Reuben's mentioning that they did the same thing with Jerusalem. I think they called it Aelia Capitolina.
Right.
The Romans, you're talking about.
Yeah.
Right.
And remember, the older form of Jerusalem is Jerusalem. That's what they should go back to. Not this newfangled name. I'm trying to find where they talk about. I know they mention it in chapter 12. Where the Persians were just using Yehud. Well, we already mentioned it, but I wanted to read it too. But whatever, we already mentioned it. It comes from the Persians.
Reuben wants to know what was wrong with the old Salem. In Genesis, that's what the original name was. When Melchizedek was ruler there, he was the king of Salem.
What was that even older than Jerusalem? Because we have Jerusalem on the Tel Dan. Yeah, I think Jerusalem is the oldest known name we have for that city, right?
I don't even know if we have an extra biblical reference to the term Salem.
Yeah, I'm not sure, but we do for Jerusalem.
Right, and I don't even know if the Bible... Well, the Bible says uses the Hebrew term Yerushalayim. That's so close to that. That's such a I wouldn't say that's another name for it, just a variation on the same.
Well, interesting about that one little section about Melchizedek is that the Bible's talking about Abraham, and he's talking to the king of Sodom, and all of a sudden they bring in Melchizedek, the priest of Salem, and then they go back to talking about the priest of Sodom. I think that's some kind of insertion that they couldn't figure out where to stick it, so they just stuck it there.
So it doesn't flow with the text. It feels like an insertion.
Yeah, to me it does.
Okay, so that's the book, guys. We're done. What'd you guys think of the book as a whole?
I really enjoyed it. I mean, it actually changed my thinking on quite a few issues. Like, previously, I really hadn't had that good of a knowledge of biblical archaeology and stuff, and just from vague comments here and here I've heard from some of the minimalists, I was thinking, you know, much less of the Bible was probably history. And they've actually, you know, persuaded me to actually accept more of it as historical than I previously would have.
Well, rereading it, I think that some of my minimalist assumptions I'm rethinking, but I still see it tending towards giving too much credit to the biblical history, I think.
I find myself siding with them, I guess partially because my first instinct is to think that a minimalist, at least just to jump and assume a minimalist position, is being too uncritical, in the sense that I think he's right that each passage deserves to be examined on its own merits, by, you know, on a case-by-case, verse-by-verse, you know, and almost to give it the benefit of the doubt until it shows that it can't be trusted. So some things seem to indicate they can be trusted, and others that they can't. And just deal with it as you look at the evidence individually, and just instead of writing it all off, which I don't think that's a critical... it certainly doesn't come from any facts, just to... You know what I'm saying? It's just brushing everything aside. It's almost like you don't have time to be bothered with the evidence.
Yeah, I think it's important for that stuff to take its place at the center of things rather than be unknown, generally speaking. But a lot of things I still have problems with there, like some of the assumptions of the book in like chapter 12. They're talking about the similarities between the Exodus story and the experience of the exilic returners. And basically they are assuming then that, well, these returners were reinterpreting the Exodus story. Well, there's other interpretations too. For instance, that this was created out of that returner experience rather than coming from anything before it. So there's just a lot of instances where I think because they're Israeli archaeologists and scholars working in Israel, that they can't always go to an extreme position, even if they wanted to.
Yeah, I think, like you said, a lot of this stuff, especially like that which you mentioned, is speculation for sure.
By the way, I want to say on that point too, you mentioned it, and earlier you had mentioned that, Doug, the idea that that part of the chapter where it talked about how these earlier stories, especially the Exodus account, is kind of a reflection of the Babylonian situation of being in exile. And it reminded me, I had read something very similar, a woman, I forget her name, who had a very Greek-sounding name, and she was trying to say, make the case that the Garden of Eden story and the expulsion from the garden is patterned after the, basically, when Adam and Eve are sent out of the Garden of Eden. She's trying to make the case that the Garden of Eden is Israel, and the sending out of the garden is basically referring to their exile in Babylon. Like, in other words, that story is patterned after their experience in Babylon, and this desire to want to return to the garden.
I don't want
that to me seems like a radical stretch to me personally. I mean, especially considering the other much more ancient strong parallels we have with like the Enuma Elish and the Epic of Gilgamesh, etc.
Dale, there's one thing I wish I could remember more details for you on this, but I can't. But I think there's the verse, and I think it's Ezekiel, that talks about the king of, I think it's the king of one of the adjacent nations, Israel, too, but it could be the Israelite king. I don't remember the context. Walking in the Garden of Eden.
Oh, King Hiram of Tyre, I think.
That might have been it. Yeah.
Actually, I think that was part of her. That was part of her. That may have been part of her reasoning too, is to show how the Eden story is basically tailored after that late setting, really, that the writers, not too far from the writers themselves, you know. In other words, the king of Tyre and so forth. But as far as the reason why that theory actually, I'm still open to it, is because the idea that the Garden of Eden is related to Palestine.
Yeah,
I think even Reuven will verify this, that there is a strong Jewish tradition of that the Garden of Eden was Israel, and that this was the borders of Eden, that is the rivers that are described, are the traditional boundaries of Israel, that is from the river Euphrates and Tigris down to the river of Egypt, and the Gihon spring is mentioned as one of the rivers is also. So, in other words, this is paradise. The original home of mankind was the promised land.
There's another thing to bring up also in the temple for decorations. You know, because of the law, they weren't allowed to have, you know, pictures of living things, really, animals themselves. No animals or people or gods or anything like that. But there were lots of plants and trees done in the artwork along the temple. So it was almost like, you know, just looking at the walls with just the carvings and stuff, it's like you're in a garden.
Exactly. In other words, so the Garden of Eden was a sanctuary, and the temple was designed after the Garden of Eden. And by the way, Reuven is saying that the door of the Garden of Eden is actually in Hebron, in the Cave of Machpelah. It's another tradition associated with that.
That's where all the patriarchs are buried, right? Or some of them, the wives. Yeah.
Just interesting theories, and it's related to, it has the same theory, that is, that these stories in the early part of the Bible may just be retellings of the later experience of Israel, or at least influenced by. So, for example, you're saying based on the Enuma Elish. So I don't have a problem with it being a merging of the two, that they're taking this creation account, the Babylonian creation account, and adapting it and tailoring it around their own experience to some extent. It's reworked around their experience, possibly.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely a possibility, because like we were saying, the final redactor probably had this all in front of him, was able to edit stuff. So if he's editing this stuff from the perspective of a post-exile person, it wouldn't be surprising if he would, you know, put in little things here and there to kind of give his readers, let him see, like, hey, this is related to what we just experienced, you know. So yeah, I don't have a problem with that, but I don't think they were invented during that period for that purpose, to just have a retelling of what just happened to them. I think that's not realistic.
Hey, Dale, talking again about the Garden of Eden thing, I believe the BBC had a documentary a few years ago called The Bible's, you know, a series called The Bible's Buried Secrets Unveiled, or something like that, or Revealed. And one of the episodes was on the Garden of Eden.
That may have been the special I was thinking about.
Yeah, and it has, I can't remember the gal's name, Dr. Francesca Shravarakapolu or something. I can't remember how to pronounce her name.
That's the one.
Yeah.
And by the way, Reuven is mentioning how people believe that Adam and Eve's bones were buried there. That is in the Cave of Machpelah. And it's interesting that when I was at the traditional, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, which is the traditional site of Jesus' crucifixion, and you see this artwork of Jesus' crucifixion over, right underneath the cross, there's a, in this illustration, there's a skull, and they say that's the skull of Adam, basically indicating that he was buried right there where Jesus was crucified. So this concept of Adam and Eve buried right in Israel, this is a very ancient belief among the Jews, and it carried on. Anyway, I just find that all fascinating. It's not just a, not purely speculative. I mean, I don't believe there was an Adam and Eve, so all that, of course, is pure speculation, but I mean, the whole... But in other words, that the Jews honestly believed that when they wrote the story of Adam and Eve, they may have actually had Israel in mind the whole time, and that all is very intriguing. And then the whole, and then when you start to see these interesting parallels between a, you know, forcing them to leave the Holy Land, is similar in many ways to how Israel's experience, a, you know, this. I forget what the term is, but basically it's a repeating of that pattern, just like Israel's experience later in Babylon is a repeating of the experience they had in leaving Egypt.
Yeah, regarding this book, again, we mentioned earlier the Richard Elliot Friedman's The Hidden Book in the Bible, where he says the J text, you know, continues past the Pentateuch and into the Reign of Solomon. Yeah, he says, reading the back cover here, a great work lies hidden in the Bible. A single author wrote nearly 3,000 years ago. It is nothing less than the first work of prose on earth. There are poems that are earlier, but this is the earliest prose literature, a long, beautiful, exciting story. And an astonishing thing is that even though it is the first, it is far from a primitive first attempt at writing. It has the qualities of the world's greatest literature. It is a masterpiece. If we had just discovered this work archaeologically, we would be impressed and excited. But something even more impressive has happened. It has been under our eyes, laced in the fabric of the best-known book in the world for thousands of years. And it was not just a part of the Bible, it was the heart of the Bible, the core work. Now we have the opportunity to read this story that no one has read for nearly 3,000 years. Its discovery at this millennial juncture in human history is like a miracle, a gift to us from our ancient past. But anyway, part of what I wanted to read about that was Friedman does say the entire thing from the Garden of Eden story to the Reign of Solomon was written by a single author. That is Friedman's view. And thus, right. it also, he puts it about the 9th or 10th century B.C. when it was written.
Yeah, he's a true believer.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'll do my thoughts on the book. I thought it was really good. Like, I don't know a lot about all this stuff. I really love their... Well, they just kind of summarize... A lot of this stuff seemed to be summarizing of other stuff, you know, especially the stuff that the Israelites, Canaanites... what I really liked about this book was underlining the 7th century setting and concerns throughout a lot of this stuff, which I thought was good evidence. But again, I need to read some of the other guys who are minimalists and see what they have to say, if they address some of this stuff. Yeah, I agree with a lot of it. I mean, it's one of the first books of its kind I've read, so obviously I'm easily persuaded because I don't have a huge background, but hopefully in the future we'll read more about this sort of thing from authors with different views. So, I liked it a lot. I learned a lot from it.
And as I've been saying all along through this book, I need to read the Old Testament itself again because this is going to give me completely new eyes for reading it.
Yeah, yep. So, any other closing thoughts on this book?
I think we talked about this before we went live, but I want to say it on the live cam. I really like how he does the bibliography in this book, the way he has it. Not just alphabetical by author for the bibliography, but he actually has it by chapter and by subject within each chapter.
Yeah.
So you can really easily find what books actually cover specifically what topics that he deals with. And I wish more books would organize the bibliographies in this manner.
Yep, that is really good. Really nice bibliography. So, is that it? Anything else? Okay, I guess I'll say we're done. We'll be starting Sebastian Mole's dissertation at the Left Hand of Marcion next week. And we can talk about what we're going to read after we go off live. So thanks, everyone, who came, did the reading. Thank you guys so much for doing the reading. I know, we all have lives outside of Google Hangouts, and it's actually a lot to ask people to read, a significant chunk every week. So really appreciate you guys who do it every week. And
I appreciate
you kind of volunteered.
I appreciate you guys pushing me to read this stuff. I mean, this is stuff that really fascinates me, but I'd be too lazy to read it if I didn't have this group, so it's good. It's making me read things I already want to read, but you haven't been able to push myself to actually go through and read.
That reminds me of a line from a Rush song. I forget exactly, I'm going to slaughter, but basically, I wrote this song for me, but the rest of you are benefiting from it. Back in Kurt's objectivist days. But yeah, I was just going to say the same thing. Like, one of the big reasons I wanted to do these hangouts was basically to force me also to read this stuff, because I know I'm bad about it, and also to have you guys who are way more well-read to discuss it with, and then, we read it, and then we discuss it, so it's kind of like, if we didn't have this hangout and we're just reading it, we're losing that whole second part of it, where we're kind of going over it again in our heads, which helps just set it a little better in our memories. So.
And once in a while, there are parts I misread when you guys start explaining how you read it. Like, oh, that's what it was supposed to say. Okay.
Exactly. Yeah. So yeah, good hangouts.
That was Anthem, based on Ayn Rand's book, Anthem.
Right. Thank you. That's it. Yep.
One reason I like this book is it covers so much of the Old Testament that it's helped me, not only the text itself, but this discussion in helping me rethink things that I have assumed, even till now. I'm carrying around things that I've had from my conservative days, and I'd like to. This forces me to rethink them and realize what I'm assuming, which possibly I shouldn't be assuming.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just to read that line real quick, since John reminded me, it's at the end of the song. It says, "Well, I know they've always told you selfishness was wrong, yet it was for me, not you, I came to write this song." And yet here, for a selfish reason, Neil Peart wrote that song, and here we all are enjoying it. Well, some of us. So anyway.
Enlightened self-interest, right?
Right.
Yeah, I don't think she was entirely right, but I have some sympathies here and there for Rand's work. We should probably go off live if we talk about that anymore. Though.
Yeah, I was just going to say, before this goes into an objectivism debate, let's end it. Thanks, everyone, again. Anyone watching in the future, hope you enjoy it. And thanks, everyone who's here. And thanks to everybody. So see you guys next week.